Really? This is not looking good for you.
Excuse me. Those that are not there that day are us right now, are the people that wasn't born yet.
They weren't born yet? So who us. God talking to the us. Air?
So
and the ones that passed away as well.
No, so, he says, let me read verse 15. It says, verse 15.
Look back at verse
10. Yo, that's a grown woman acting like that?
Listen, verse 10 and 11 just told you who was all there. Did it not? You are standing today, all of you, before the Lord your God, the heads of your tribes, your elders, and your officers, and all the men of Israel, your little ones, your wives, and the foreigner. Did you miss that part?
Yeah, can he explain the foreigner before he tries to jump to verse 15?
I would love that. Who that is? They just fell out the monkey tree.
Let's read it again.
Okay, sure will. You are standing here today, all of you, before the Lord your God, the heads of your tribes, your elders, your officers, all the men of Israel, your little ones, your wives, and the foreigner. Mm-hmm. Where they come from? They just fell out the sky?
Oh, no, we're about to explain it. In the beginning of verse 10, what does it say? Ye stand. Hold on. I'll just explain it. In the beginning of verse 10, it says, in the KJV, it says,
this is the black stand
this day.
Anywhere
we
go,
so the people that are standing there
when we talk about
are Israelites and strangers. But then when you go down to verse 13, it says,
You skipped over 11.
Okay, we're going to read it all the way through.
All right. We're going to read it all the way through.
In the beginning of verse 10, he's talking about the people that's standing there. So let's read. Ye stand this day. So pay attention to what I'm saying about who's standing there.
Black
ye stand
this day. Jesus to death.
I'm about to read it, but let me finish.
We
ye stand this
Jesus
day, all
death.
Of you, before
we
the Lord your
Jesus.
God, your captains, your of your tribes, your elders, and your officers
we
with all
like
the men of Israel,
of
your little ones,
Jesus.
Your wives, and thy strangers. So that's all everybody standing there that is in thy camp, from the hewer
I'm
of the wood
so,
unto the drawer of the water. Now,
pray
verse 12,
every day on
that
just
thou shouldest enter into the covenant with the Lord thy God, and into his oath, which the Lord thy God maketh with thee this day, that he may establish thee today for a people unto himself, and that he may be unto thee a God,
now,
as he has said unto thee, and as he has sworn unto thy fathers.
Be.
Fathers are those.
No, keep going.
Okay, as he has said unto thee, as he has sworn unto thy fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. Neither with you only do I make this covenant and this oath, but with him that standeth here with us today, before the Lord our God, and also with him that is not here with us this day. Who wasn't there? I wasn't
but
there.
Who was
Nobody.
Standing, but who was standing there? The stranger was standing there also.
You're not paying attention.
No, I'm not.
Listen to what it's in verse 10. It says, ye stand this day, all of you. So then he further explains who's standing there, right? Right or wrong? So the stranger is only part of the people that's standing there. But then in verse 12, he says that thou shouldest enter into a covenant with the Lord thy God and into his oath, which the Lord thy God maketh with thee this day, that he may establish thee.
Wait. You keep getting back. We ask, okay, who's the stranger?
Man, this reading comprehension is bad.
It is because how can y'all
do we need to put on some Schoolhouse Rock? I'm just saying.
How can y'all not understand that he's talking about the people that's standing there initially, and then he says the covenant that I made with your father.
We ask you, who is the stranger or? In other translations, it uses the term foreigner. So,
yes.
Who is that? they're there.
The stranger is the stranger. It's the heathen. It's the Gentile. It's the person that's non-Israelite.
So, but they heard the same thing, didn't they?
Right. Okay.
This is crazy, man. Listen.
Y'all, you talking about reading comprehension. You got to
understand. Yeah, you got bad reading comprehension. Do you believe that? Wait a minute. I have one question. Do you believe that you're under a curse?
I believe we all under a curse. If you hear me.
I'm not under a curse.
Oh, yes,
curse.
Yo, yes, you are.
No.
I ain't got to be under no curse. So let me ask you something. I'm going to put the scripture on you. 2 Corinthians 5.
Do you see how y'all got away from the point?
So let's go back, and they all attack you at one time, bro.
You see what I'm saying? I can't even get a word in.
Exactly. They're not paying attention
to the fact that
BahaiFaith.org. They don't want to hear the truth. It's not meant to them. They don't want to hear
it. Here's the thing.
I don't even know who you are. So you've been all day. So let's go back. We looking at verse.
Oof. I tell you, I like to be in the world. I am not of this world, especially when I'm in the world and it sounds like that. Talk about noisy vibrations. What instrument would you use to accompany that sound? A lot of static would work. But honestly, that's like the power of Black church, that no matter where we are, when we get together talking about God, talking about Jesus, that kind of thing could happen. People who have studied the Bible know it well, that they even dream it. Just throw it out, pour it out as is. It is their truth. And then as you study the history of books and how governments, for example, conquering people have rolled into neighborhoods and burned the libraries and burnt the books, put them in piles, burnt them. When they could take pictures and make movies and put it on the news, they burnt the books and showed us, like, we're stopping the people's brains and their thoughts, their imaginations, their human ability to write things down. Paper is so flammable. And now we're in a digital age. BahaiFaith.org is a place that I remember when I started looking into the Baha'i Faith and investigating it. I knew about Dizzy Gillespie being a Baha'i. I was so lucky when I was first living in New York City and Dizzy Gillespie had passed away that I was asked to sing in a group of singers that they were putting together. Jimmy Owens wrote a beautiful, beautiful orchestral piece for a jazz band called 100 Trumpets Salute to Dizzy. And he organized 100 trumpets north, east, south, and west that heralded the greatness of Dizzy Gillespie's music. And I was one of the singers that sang. I sang, oh my God, I got to talk to Jayon about it. It's been like, I don't know how long Dizzy Gillespie's been gone, but that's how long ago it was that we did this music. And I remember learning Con Alma at that time. And being told that this was like not a Baha'i funeral, but it was a Baha'i funeral. But it was so much more because every jazz musician that could get there was there. And I was there. And I got to sing with so many beautiful Baha'i people. So that was the first time that I encountered the Baha'i faith without anybody telling me that. It's just how it felt. It felt like everybody loved each other and that everybody welcomed each other and felt that each other was related and that we all were related to Dizzy and that we were all just family together. And we had lost a great brother, a great uncle. Whew, yeah. So I encourage you to do that because, you know, otherwise, especially if you're Black, you know, you need to open up your mind and your heart to understand that the Baha'i faith has some new, not so much words of Jesus, because that has been documented at the time that it was documented in what we know as the Bible. And we've seen the many forms that the Bible over the 2,000 plus years has been. Well, no, the Bible's less than 2,000 years old when you think about it, right? Because it wasn't written till a couple hundred years after Jesus had walked the earth. So this was part of the storytelling of humanity that was written down after the fact, because they were still talking about Jesus. They were still talking about Jesus. And when they figured out, we just got to figure out how to write this down or how to just keep telling everybody. This is what we were listening to in a, not an argument, but a passionate, the passion of Christ.
Is that not your point?
Who did he make the promise to? Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob.
He made the promise to Abraham that through him, every nation will be blessed.
Exactly. So through Abraham, all nations will be blessed. All right. But does that mean all nations will be in rulership? No.
But we're not talking about rulership. No, we're talking about who did God. Wait. You're jumping subjects now.
Sir, you're
talking about rulership, and we're talking about who did God give his covenant to. You're talking blessed about rulership. That's two different things. You're changing blessed the subject.
This blessed don't mean covenant. Blessed does not mean covenant.
What?
Okay. Blessed does not mean covenant. You can get a blessing right now.
And I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse those who curse you, and all families of the earth shall be blessed.
Blessed does not covenant.
And that is what? No.
That's what I was going to go to when you stopped me.
That's the covenant that God, the promise that God made to who? Abraham, right? Genesis 12.
So is he promising that they will be blessed, but not receive salvation?
Blessed.
The Bible says that who is the seed that the seed is Christ.
Christ.
Hold on. Let me see.
That's what I was trying to let him get out, because I thought that's what he was trying to say, is that, you know, that verse 15 when it said that I made this promise to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I just wanted to bring out that the promise was made to Abraham that through him all the nation would be blessed. And then we get over to the New Testament. It says that seed is Christ.
Yes, that's exactly right, what you're saying. All nations shall be blessed because of Christ.
They will
be blessed. But that's Psalm 29 and 2. If you go to Psalms 29 and 2, that's your answer. How all the nations are going to be blessed.
No, you can't give me that. No, that's not my answer. Because
that's the answer in the Bible.
Well, that's the answer that you're giving, but that doesn't mean it's the right, correct answer to what I'm saying.
Do you know what it says?
The seed is Christ. I don't need to go back to Psalms. I'm talking about Jesus right now. That seed is Christ.
It comes in the volume of the book, right, sis?
Okay. I think that you don't want to listen because you're trying to teach. I'm gonna talk to Cherry, and you can just you can just listen. So
I bet you would talk to Cherry.
Yeah. See, this is what I'm talking about, because see, he had a chance to speak. I haven't said anything. So, anyways, what he's saying isn't the truth, because the Bible says that the promise seed was Jesus Christ. And so if the families of the earth would be blessed through Abraham's seed, and that seed is Christ, and he's agreeing that the nations can be blessed, and that seed is Christ, he's saying that they're being blessed through Christ. Where do they get, what blessing are they receiving through Christ if it's not salvation? That's my
question. Psalms 90,
Psalms 19:2 just said, that's the blessing that they get. When the righteous are in authority, the world rejoices. That's the blessing. They don't have to cry no more. They don't have no tears, no more war, no more hunger, none of that stuff. Why? Because Christ will be in charge and the Israelites will be in charge with him.
No, that's not what scripture says,
sir. Christ will be reigning and ruling. Yes, I would agree with that part. But however, you being in authority for what? You haven't done anything.
And how's that blessing? 144,000. How's that being a blessing?
Well, hold on. Let's see.